I just know that every woman that's coming has a role to play. Like, she's being called up higher right now, and this conversation will be the spark of her realization that she is included in the moving forward of nations.
Hi there, this is Cecile Watson from ladiespeaking.com, where we feature empowering conversations with influential women of the Caribbean. We are a pandemic baby, born in defiance of the forces that would seek to overwhelm us, and as a statement of how, as women, we can indeed be resilient, audacious, and persistent. Our mission is to empower ladies through inspiring conversations that encourage confidence. Welcome to our first episode of Ladies Speaking. You can join us live on the second Sunday of every month by heading over to ladiespeaking.com and get added to our invitation list. Coming up, you will be hearing from our first sister in spotlight, Dion Johnson, the womanologist. Sit back, relax, and enjoy this empowering conversation.
But before we start, I want to acknowledge God. He is my creator, my sustainer, and he has brought me to this place today. And I call on him to be present, and I audaciously demand of him that just as he has brought us to this gathering, just as he has commanded it, that he will also take us through it to connect us for good and to advocate for each other and to fulfill his will in all our lives. And it takes us to our very first guest of Ladies Speaking, my friend, Dion Johnson, the womanologist. I'm not going to share anything more about her beyond what you have already read in the bio. I'm the best person to introduce herself. So with that, let's welcome Dion. Hi, Dion. Let's get you on screen now.
Hello, 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 everyone. Good evening, good night, as my granny would say. And love to all of you from London. I'm just so excited about being here. And don't let my English accent fool you. We are Jamaican. I'm delighted to be here with you all tonight.
Great.
Thank you, Lindsay.
Yes, so Dion, to get us started, maybe you can just share a little bit about yourself, your background, and what brought you here to the point where you're writing this book, Influential Woman.
Oh my gosh, that's really loaded. a bit about me. I was born in the UK, born in a little place called Bristol, a city in Bristol, England's second city. So I'm a city girl from the UK. And when I was about 12 years old, I decided that I was gonna be a nurse and that I was going to move to London, to the bright lights in the big city, and follow my dad, because my mum and dad divorced when I was quite young, and I really missed my dad a lot when I was young. So I decided that I was gonna go to London to do my nurse training, be near my dad and my grandma. And that's what I did. When I was 18, I kind of packed my bags and set off for adult life in London, joined my father, my grandmother, and I've been here ever since. And that was a long time ago. So I've been living in London, started off in nursing. I liked nursing, but it wasn't my heart, you know? And so after I had a baby, in my mid-20s, I decided not to go back to nursing, but to go into midwifery. So I trained again as a midwife. And that's where I really found my passion for women. You know, I found where I belonged. I was an intuitive midwife. I loved being alongside women. That's what midwife means. It means alongside woman, with woman. And it was just a great time of learning about the power that we are as women, and learning about how we bring forth new life and how we conceive things that aren't yet here on earth, and then we bring it forth. And it was a very important time of my development, learning about the power of women. And then I got really fed up of it. After years of doing pioneering work in midwifery, just got really sick of it, and then decided that it was time to leave. And it was at that point, when I decided to leave midwifery, that I realized I didn't know who I was outside of midwifery. It was all I'd ever done. And I desperately wanted to leave. I had a young child. I was raising her by myself. And midwifery would make me, I had a pager, and my clients could contact me directly and be calling me out at all times of the day and night. So every time I was on call, my baby had to go and stay somewhere just in case I had to go out in the middle of the night. And it got to the place where, you know, these women would call me and tell me about their cracked nipples or their waters breaking. And I just didn't care. Like, I just wanted to throw this pager away because it wasn't working with my life. You know, I was really, it hurt me when my baby said she didn't want to go and stay over there, she didn't want to go and stay over here. And yet I had to make her go because I had to go to work. And so it took me a long time, you know, to really work out who the heck I am outside of this. I've invested heavily in becoming qualified. Sorry about that noise there. I'd invested heavily in becoming qualified. I spent a lot of time, you know, mastering the craft of midwifery, and it's all I'd done. And so I just didn't know who I was. It wasn't working with my life, but I didn't know how to be anything else. I didn't know how to do anything else.
So tell us, Dion, you've written now a book called Influential Woman.
Yeah.
And you call yourself the Womanologist. And I know you speak a lot about womanity. Tell us what that's all about.
Well, it all started back there in my early days of midwifery, when I really learned about the power of women. And fast forward to now, when I'm coaching women. Right now, my work is really involved in coaching and being a strategic ally and advisor to women in senior leadership. So when women come to me, they usually come because they're struggling with some kind of conflict, or they've got some kind of work issue, they've lost their career direction, there's something going on with their work life. But time and time again, whenever we would work together, the feedback that I would get was that I came to you, Dion, because I thought I had an issue with my boss, I thought I had an issue with the workload or my career direction. But what really got healed was my inner woman. What really got touched was my self-perception, my identity got touched. Like, you healed my inner way that I see myself as a woman. And this was saying to me, people say this to me a lot, that when we work together, they come because of their work life, but what was really being touched, what was really being cracked open and looked at and cleaned out and healed and redefined and rewritten, was the way that we see ourselves as women. And so that's how womanity, that's how the womanologist came out of the healing process that my clients go through. And then womanity was really, womanity is really about, well, we all talk about humanity, but my faith and my journey with women has really taught me that we're distinct. You know, that women are distinct as human creatures. And so I don't think we're just human. I think we're women, and that our nature is womanity.
Okay. Yes. So I think this probably is a good point where I read your book. It was a great read. For those of you on the line, when Dion asked me to take a read of it, I was so burdened with so many different things. I kept delaying, and I was like, oh my God, let me like this book, right? And when I got started, I was captivated. And I remember in particular, you had one story in there about a young girl called Carly. And I thought maybe you could read that section for us here so that the women gathered here can get a sense of what you're saying, because that story of Carly underscored the stories that we come into this life with and that we carry into adulthood and that we let define us whether or not it is our truth or not.
Before I read about Carly, I want to just address the women in the room. You know, I want to talk to you first. Before I tell you about Carly and why I wrote about Carly, I'll share that when George Floyd got murdered, we all saw it, right? George Floyd got murdered the other day. And recently, I put out after he died, I put out a series of posts through my networks. And I was asking the question, you know, where we're at, you know, what, how are we? What are we thinking? What's happening? And I found three really strong responses when I put this out. The first one was indifference. It's a one-off isolated case. Oh, it's just America, or he's a bad one. Like, it's hype. Don't believe the hype. It's not really a big thing. So indifference and really denial of this issue of inequality. And then the second response was shock. So people were saying things like, I can't believe that in 2020, we're still talking about inequality. We're still talking about racism. We're still talking about, you know, all the isms. How come in 2020 we're still talking about that? But then the third response that I received was from women who said, yes, I'm heartbroken, because I see this inequality playing out in every area of my life, not just professionally, but personally. I see inequality and it breaks my heart because I don't know what to do. I want it gone. I want the world to be different. I want the world that I'm growing old in, the world that I'm handing over to my children and my children's children. I want it better. I want the world to be better, but I just don't know what I can do about it. It doesn't feel like I can do anything. It feels like this is just the way that the world is and there's nothing we can do about that. And that is the sentiment that I find so much. And so as I began to write this book, one of the questions that was really coming up for me was how we're so brilliant. We're such brilliant women. Some of us are loftily educated. Some of us are, you know, have groundbreaking experience. We're pioneers, entrepreneurial. We're great women. And we care about the world that we live in, but so often we don't feel like we've got what it takes to make it happen. And inequality kept coming up a lot. Inequality kept coming up as a big issue for me as I was writing the book. And one day my coach asked me, she said, why do you care so much about inequality? Why do you care so much? And I had to really think about that. And as a professional, you know, sometimes when we talk about inequality, we think about graphs and science and data. But when I really closed my eyes and thought, why do I care about inequality? It's because I realized I'm a woman. I'm in a man's world. I am a black woman in a white man's world. I'm a Christian in a secular world. I'm facially disfigured in a beauty-obsessed world. And so I began to realize that we know, don't we, as women, we know personally about inequality. And I began to think about the stories that I'd seen over the years, even on the labor ward, you know, stories. My specialism when I was a midwife was looking after young girls in pregnancy. So I was responsible for developing the service to help these young girls to, you know, deal with their social issues, make it through education, and not be excluded from their families, and, you know, building their family unit. So it was a very big, broad role. But that's how come when I think about inequality, I don't think about it as pie charts and data. I think about it as real stories, real people like us who are not able to really come into the fullness of who they are, not really able to express our greatness like we have it. We've got greatness, but there's just this barrier to expressing it. And so that's why I wrote about Carly. So let me read a little. Let's see. So when I was writing about inequality, can you hear me? When I was writing about inequality, I thought about it from mother's perspectives, and then I thought about it from daughters. So I'm picking up where I'm talking about how I see it affecting the daughters. Of course, that particular young girl's unique path has led her to that hard, cold delivery bed. But in many respects, she was, well, like many others I'd met before her, a child with daddy abandonment issues and a mum who'd gone out to work. One afternoon, I left my office to attend a meeting, and I encountered Carly, a girl who would serve as a mirror to reflect the hidden impact of inequality. As I entered the car park, I noticed a group of boys huddled in a pack. On approaching them, I saw a young girl caught up in their midst. They seemed to be pushing and pulling her, bouncing her from one pair of hands to the next. She looked like a lamb among a pack of wolves. Without thinking, I ran towards the girl, roaring, "Leave her alone!" Eventually, with a little resistance, and a lot of lip, the boys ran off. "What are you doing out here with them?" I asked the girl, not even considering that that might be none of my business. Carly told me the story. The boys were from her school, and one of them wants to be my boyfriend, she announced. She looked really scared and overwhelmed, and as we talked, she opened up. She explained that all the popular girls had boyfriends, and having one meant you had to have sex. She helped me understand that although she wanted a boyfriend, she wasn't so keen on the sex part. And as far as she was concerned, one came with the other. My mother's heart instincts kicked in. I wanted to wrap up this little girl in my arms and take her and make her hear me. "Listen," I said to her, looking deep into her eyes. "Do you know how beautiful you are? Do you know how valuable you are? You don't have to tolerate this, and you don't have to be around it. You deserve to be treated like gold because you're valuable. You can do anything you want, and you don't have to do anything that you don't want." As I gushed my truest convictions, I found myself wondering if Carly could hear me, if what I was saying was landing in her understanding. Then she laughed. I can still hear it now. There I was, pouring my heart out to her, and she laughed. It wasn't a "you're so funny" kind of laugh, or "I'm tickled pink" kind of laugh. But it was more of a chuckle that said, "Chats would be a fine thing. There's no way that all of that is happening for me. Who are you trying to kid?" I wondered how this can happen when an individual's potential is so great. Where do these flawed messages come from? And once more came that familiar breaking of my heart. This girl has no idea how much she matters. I realized she thinks this is just the way things go for people like me.
Dion, I read that account, and Even as I listen to you again, I could just feel my heart beating. I could just feel the sensation of so many hurt little girls out there growing into adulthood and not healing the way they need to. And what do we, when we've come this journey, how can we help in that journey? I also remember in your book, you made mention of your role as a midwife, and you delivered a triplet, I believe.
Yeah.
And talked about how, to tell us about that part of the book. Tell us about that part.
Before we move on to that part of the book again.
Yeah, I want, because the part that I'm trying to speak to there is how we come and the journey we take. Because I think it's a good link back to the Carly story and the stories that we hear after we arrive. So just share that piece quickly.
So the story that I told, I was a midwife for a long time, so I delivered a lot of babies. Like really, I was trying to work it out the other day, how many babies I delivered. And it really is in the thousands. I was the first person to lay hands on a few thousand human beings coming into the world. So it's a really privileged position. But I told the story in the book of a woman that came into labor ward, huffing and puffing, really nearly ready to deliver her baby. And as we ushered her into the room, she divulged that actually she was having triplets and that she was only 30 weeks pregnant. So she was a whole 10 weeks early. So I don't know if you know about pregnancy, but that's an emergency situation. So the rooms quickly filled up with, you know, the intensive care teams, and you know, we were all getting ready, and I was the midwife that was going to be delivering these babies. And so as I parted this woman's leg, I saw the first baby coming very fast, delivered this first baby. And as I pulled out this baby, as I received this baby, the baby looked at me and I realized that this baby had a personality. This baby had something. And, you know, it was as if the baby was saying, you know, wow, this is, where am I? Wow, this is a really cool place. This baby seemed so full of wonder and so full of awe and curiosity. And I noticed this in the split second that it took me to hand this baby to the intensive care team. And then the second baby came. And this second baby came out and had a completely different persona. So this second baby sounded like this, it looked like this. Chuh. You know, since I'm in that sleep, I was, you know, I put me back. I'm not ready. Leave me alone, man. The baby seemed disgruntled at being disturbed, wanted to go back, didn't really want to be here. Like, leave me alone. Let me do my own thing. Don't bother me. This baby really had that kind of way about it. Those were two boys. The next baby, the third baby, was ready to come, and it was baby girl. And baby girl was coming out. And as she came out real elegantly. And as she came out, she took hold of my arm, and the two of us looked eyeball to eyeball. And she had swag. Yeah, I'm early. Yeah, all right. So what? You know, she had the kind of rude girl attitude, you know? Yeah, right. So when the really interesting thing about this story, and the reason I tell it and I wrote about it in the book, is because I visited those babies in special care for months after their birth. And all three of them kept that personality, had those personalities, you know, and the two boys really struggled, but this girl, she fought her way through. She was strong, she was resilient, she was, you know, she really had something about her, and it really showed. It stayed, that what I saw in the delivery room was who she was. And it reminded me so powerfully that we come here as someone. You know, think about that for a minute. You were someone when you landed here, when you got to the planet, when you got into your mother's womb, when you were born, you were already someone. And I can't tell you just how powerful it is for when I'm working with my clients to consider that, to consider who you were before, when you were in your mother's womb and when you got here. You have to read the book because it's a really powerful, powerful exercise to really think about who you came here as. Yes, because you're still her.
And you know, I mentioned it because when I read the book, I pick up the phone and I call my mother, who happens to be on the call, I believe.
Yeah. Hi, mommy.
Hi, mommy. I said, so mommy, what was I like when I was born? Because I wanted to understand whether I had that fiery spirit, you know. My mother responds to me, I don't know, you were like a baby. So I had a big laugh at that because she says, you were the third of five girls. How am I supposed to remember what you were, you know? I said, was I fussy? Was I, you know, cry baby? What? She says, all my children were not fussy. None of my children were fussy, you know. You were quiet girls, you know. So I know that was a powerful point you made in your book, but it does cause us to go back, and we do sometimes have to go back before we can come forward, right?
Yeah, I think it's really powerful to, you know, the reason that story is in the book is because I share my belief that if we're going to be influential change makers, which is really what the book is about, mm-hmm. if we're really going to be those influential change makers in our organizations and in our communities and in our nation and in our world ultimately, then we really have to know who we are. We have to remember who we are. Like when I met Carly had no idea of how great she was. Right. Carly had no idea of what she was here to do or the fact that she was here to do something important. Right. She had, that was not instilled in Carly.
Beyond in your book, you covered 7 habits that you have discovered through your work with women and also your life journey. And earlier in your conversation, you talked about your disfigurement, and that's probably the elephant in the room. Maybe you can talk about that because you do address it in your book as well. And what brought you to your knees and caused you to be so willing, because Dion talks about showing up. She talks about showing up, speaking up, and shaking things the hell up. And it was a moment in your life that gave you the courage to do that. When we build this community, we're talking about resilience, audacity, and persistence. And I certainly think your story is one of those. And so maybe you can share a little about that and share a little about the habits, and then we'll open to Q&A.
You know that when I had to learn that I came here as somebody. I had to learn that. In my big, big grown-up adult age, I had to learn that. And so I don't think we automatically know it. But my learning it really came to a big head in 2009. I was born with a facial disfigurement. And when I was 4 years old, I was gifted an artificial eye and dark glasses. My face didn't develop conventionally in the womb. So when I was in the womb, I wasn't conventional. My face didn't develop. I had asymmetrical face. And from birth, right the way through to early adulthood, I was in a process of corrective surgery, having my face lined up, made symmetrical, repaired where the lip didn't develop properly. So I had a lot, my appearance had always been an issue. And when I was 4 years old, I was gifted this artificial eye, dark glasses. So they would cover up this aspect of my face. And the point of that was to hide. The point of that was to make me look more normal. The point of that was to conceal my disfigurements. And what I learned from that really early age is that when there is something not right about you, or when something's not normal, or when something doesn't look like everybody else, then you need to hide that. That's not something you let people see. You put that away. And that's how I lived my life. I call it the beginning of my life behind the mask. I was 4 years old. I was gifted an artificial eye and these dark glasses, and I hid. And I spent my life hiding, not consciously, but these eye and glasses, these were metaphors for the way that I would go on to understand how to live my life. That I didn't let people see me. I didn't let people know who I was. And then in 2009, I went through a series of painful events where children would point at my face and laugh. I was a grown woman, but these children making fun of me and pointing at my face really brought me to my knees and really made me put my hands up in the air like this and say, God, you know, something's wrong, something's hurting. I don't know why. And I had this conversation with God in 2009. And he asked me these questions that I now ask my clients, and I'm asking everyone on the call, you know, why don't you let people see the real you? Like, who are you? And why don't you let people see the real? Why are you hiding? Why don't you take those masks off? Why don't you let people see you? Why don't you show up for real? And that was in 2009. And I have to tell you that when I had that conversation, I really had no idea what it meant to show up for real. I was only talking about my face at that time. And what I knew was I couldn't let you look at me. I didn't want you to look at my face, because I felt like making you see this would be cruel. Making you see my face wouldn't be fair. And when I heard myself saying that, when I realized that that's what I believed about myself, that I was offensive or challenging to be with, then I decided that I was going to change all that and learn how to show up for real. The thing that I really want to point out about this is that in my work with women, I found that you don't have to have a face like mine to have those same thoughts about yourself. Like, you don't have to have a face like mine to think that the real you is offensive. You don't have to have a face like mine to realize that you don't feel palatable, or you don't feel like the real you is acceptable or needed or wanted in your world. That it's a common theme that comes out of my work with women, is that I'm seeing that there are so many of us beautiful, talented, brilliant women with education and more degrees in the thermometer, and yet there's behind their masks, their metaphorical masks, there are beliefs, often hidden, deep and unconscious, that I'm too something or other, too black, too mouthy, too this, or not good enough, not lovable, not a huge disappointment. I found myself behind the mask, when I did the work to kind of unmask what it was that I was really thinking about myself, the beliefs that I thought would make me unacceptable to the world, was that I was ugly and I was unlovable and I was a huge disappointment. Those were the thoughts that I had, not in the top of my head. In the top of my head, I was a girl about town. I was qualified, I was educated, I was making money, I was doing the thing, I was good. But life was hard. And I didn't know why life was hard. My heart was sore. My mind was heavy. And I didn't understand that I was pushing and I was great on the outside, but on the inside, behind, there was other things going on. It was mismatched inside and outside. And I realized that it wasn't just my mask that I'd learned to hide when I was 4 years old, that it was myself. I'd been so hidden because I thought that, you know, my granny used to tell me about that mask. She used to lick me from my mouth like this, just, you know, that mold, that blasted malt. you know, she used to lick me on my mouth and tell me, and then she would sing a song. Oh, you are a cross Jordan, Dion. Oh, you are a cross Jordan, Dion. Your hymn book lost and your prayer book lost. Oh, you are a cross Jordan. And we'd all sing it like a family joke, but what she was saying to me was, you're just so bad that you won't be able to cross Jordan. And it was a family joke, but those things were internalized. The world told me that my skin color was not influential. You know, there were all these messages, and we live in a world that tells us all kinds of messages about ourselves. We live in a world that tells us all kinds of things about who we're supposed to be and who we're not. And I found that just to survive, we put on our mask, we grit our teeth, especially us Black women. We grit our teeth and we're pushing through life, but we don't address how we're internalizing these messages that are coming at us. And that's what's really happened in my story as I've learned to take my masks off and show up for real.
That's a great story, Dion. And I think it's also a great segue into the habits you learned along the way. And maybe you can touch on those quickly before we open it to Q&A.
So I want to share that I care about the state of the world. I care about inequality and injustice and racism and sexism. And I want to be part of that. I feel like I was born to be part of the solution. And yet there are all these mixed messages about why I'm never going to be taken seriously in high level leadership, or I'm never going to be able to really make things different. And so I wrote the book because I'm not the only one that feels that way. I'm not the only woman that cares about the world but wants to make a difference but has conflicting self-perceptions or sense of identity or perception from the outside in. And so I've been on this journey of growing as an influencer and a woman and a leader and a change maker myself. And so the book touches on, what does it take for us? What do we have to become? What do we have to do in order for us to become the kind of world changer that we're dreaming of being, the kind of world changer that we want, that the world needs right now? And I worked out that in my journey, I've had to do three really pivotal things. And that's what I'm sharing with you, that we all need to. We need to heal. We need to heal. I've heard so many stories of, through the generations, just what women have gone through. Forget you and I, just think about our ancestors and the people that have gone before us, the women that have gone through. Think of all the things that they've tolerated, and now we've come and we're tolerating, and we've gone through, and we're stretched. We've been chattel, we've been sold, we've been trafficked, we've been degraded, we've been knocked about. Womanity, I'm talking. We have survived through the centuries to here, but we've had so much to deal with historically and now personally. Each one of us have our own stories about what we've been through, what the caregivers did, what the teacher said, what our relationship with men, our relationship with other women. We could spend a year sharing our stories right here. And I'm saying that if we want to develop our influence in the world, we need to heal. Healing is available, and we have to pursue healing and wholeness. So that's the first thing. The second thing that we really have to do is, if we want to up our influence and be taken seriously and really shift the needle on some of the most prolific problems in our world, we must begin to get our heads straight. We must begin to get our heads straight. We have so many. I get a chance to sit with women, and I'm telling you, brilliant women, educated women, beautiful women. And the thoughts that operate deep down, even unconsciously, our heads are noisy and they're in a mess. And we can't just keep thinking it's normal. We have to decide to commit to handling what's going on in our heads, handling our sense of identity, handling our self-perception. We have to quieten down the noise. We have to decipher what's true and what's BFDL, what's a big fat dirty lie. We have to be able to separate the truth from the facts. We have to get our heads straight. And we're so busy, aren't we? We're so busy, our lives are so full, we've got so much on, we're spinning so many plates, that often I find that women are healing everybody else, looking after everybody else, and this head is so full that we can't be our best selves. We can't ascend to this level of influence that we're being called to if we don't get our heads straight. So we have to be deliberate about that. And then the third thing that I found that if we want to be influential, we really need to think about is our hook, H-O-O-K, our hook. My definition of this is the thing that we want to captivate the people that we want to influence. How are we going to take hold of their attention? How are we going to hold on to their attention so that they don't wander off and think of us as irrelevant? That's our message, the thing that we want the world to understand from our perspective. The thing that we believe that we're here as messengers to deliver, the thing that we, our vision, the idea that we have, the mission that we want to see in the world. You know, I sit with women who are positioned at the head of organization, at the head of public service, at the head of the judicial system, and they have a heart full of desire for a better world. And yet this is not well articulated. This is not well put together, thought through. It's not well thought out. It's not well designed. And as influential women, we must pay attention to that. We must become experts. We must develop our brand. We must develop our credibility. We must develop our message that we can use to hook attention of the people that we want to influence. And so when I realized that was my journey, that this is my journey, that these three things were working together to help me grow as an influencer, I realized that the way that those three were really coming to raising up was through the development of habits.
So there you have it. You have just heard from Dion Johnson, the womanologist. She shared perspectives from her debut book, Influential Woman. I hope that the message shared here has indeed inspired your thinking and encouraged your confidence. Now remember, we go live every second Sunday of the month. So why not head on over to ladiespeaking.com right now to get added to our invitation list. I am Cecile, your host. Until next time, love and blessings. Walk good, my friends.